Thank you very much. So I'd like to thank organizers for organizing this wonderful conference and also giving me this opportunity. So I'm going to talk about, as usual, complex dynamics, especially holomorphic function near the fixed point. And I assume that the derivative at the fixed point has a modulus 1, and it is like an irrational rotation. Okay, so the fixed point is called irrationally indifferent fixed point, and I want to study the local dynamics around the fixed point. But before going further, since it is the people working on the complex dynamics is probably the minority in this room, so let me just mention that for such a dynamics, if you, for example, start with a polynomial, there's coexisting different behaviors. One is like a rotation like, because the derivative at the fixed point is like a rotation. The other side, if it's a polynomial, the global dynamics is chaotic, so the entropy is like a log of the degree. And then on the rotation like side, for example, if it is conjugate to a rotation, then you know what happens in this region. But in general, you may not have such a region. So if it's conjugate, it's called linearizable, and the region of conjugacy is called the Ziegler disk. But it may happen that the map is not conjugate to a rotation, but still the orbit moves under the influence of irrational rotation in this case. Okay? Especially in this case, the Perez-Markov has defined an invariant set called the hedgehogs, and this is the main topic of my talk. Okay? So the orbit is not quite a rotation, but somehow behaves like a rotation in certain sense. So it is not my topics, but for example, if you think about area preserving map in dimension 2, there are also this type of coexisting behavior, the chaotic part and the rotation-like part, like a KM theory. And when it fails to have a KM torus, what happens to the dynamics? And this is like the complex case of such a question. And well, my goal is to describe this invariant set around the fixed point in terms of what's called the straight brush model, which is initially defined for complex exponential maps. So the Julia set for certain complex exponential map looks like this, the black thing. And well, this is a bit complicated. It's called the Cantor bouquet, and Lasser-Lempe has defined a simplified model, the topological model for such an invariant set, which is called the straight brush model. So the goal of my talk today is to propose a similar model for the invariant set or hedgehogs for such an irrational and different fixed point. Okay? And the main ingredient is the theory of renormalization for such a fixed point, and you use a near parabolic or cylinder renormalization. And then we use a dynamical chart and then Joule odometer, but I will explain it in a minute. Okay. So before going further to my talk, let me just try to recover from the previous work the week, because well, there are many people here who have attended the last 2 weeks of School of Dynamical Systems, and there was a course by Marco Martens on the theory of renormalizations or renormalization low dimensions. Okay, well, there are two typical topics in this thing, the object, one, real one-dimensional one, but the general idea is that if you start with a dynamical system with a discrete time, then you try to select some sub-region so that some orbit, not necessarily all, but many orbits return to this region. Then you can just rescale this region to a fixed size, or rescaling may not mean affine, or in our case, it will be very far from affine, but in a sense, it is some kind of rescaling to blow it up to a standard size or standard region, and then the first return map to this region will define the renormalization of the original map F. So it's a procedure to create a new dynamics starting from the old dynamics. Okay. And for example, if the return time is fixed, you can just conjugate by rescaling this way. And it is not always the case that the constant, the return time is constant. But anyway, this is a kind of global idea. Okay. And why do you consider such a renormalization? First of all, if you have a high iterate, if you need a high iterate to come back, then it corresponds to a fewer iterates of the renormalized map. And also, if you are blowing up this region to the larger scale, that means fine orbit structure will be blown up to the larger scale. Okay? And well, if you do it only once, it doesn't really make sense. But it is very important if you are able to do this construction infinitely many times. So starting from one dynamics, you construct R of F. Then from this one, you may try to fix some region like this one here and construct the second one and so on. And if you have a successive construction for F, then it helps you to understand the dynamics of the original F, like what's the structure of the orbit, or what's the invariant set, or rigidity, or bifurcation. Okay? And so that picture is like this. So starting from one, you renormalize, blowing up this region. And then from this one, you blow up again, and so on. And well, period of renormalization may be different at each stage. Okay. And also, once you set up this way, the procedure of renormalization can be considered as metadynamics defined in the space of dynamical systems of a certain class. So for example, even if you start with a one-dimensional map, this renormalization is acting on the space of certain dynamical systems. Usually it's infinite dimensional. And somehow the behavior of this dynamics is much simpler than the original dynamics itself. And sometimes it has a fixed point or it has a hyperbolic behavior so that you can conclude something for this one. And then that allows you to conclude something about the original dynamics. So this is a global idea of renormalization. Okay? And also, if you study the dynamical systems, if you can, for example, integrate to study the orbit, and if you know complete the orbit, it is okay. But usually, you have to change the coordinate to understand the dynamics. But if one or a finite number of coordinate changes is enough, then you just finish there, and you get a new coordinate and understand the dynamics there. But typically, in this situation, finite number of coordinate change doesn't end, and it doesn't give you enough information. But if you have an infinite sequence of this renormalization, and if you happen to have a good control on this sequence of renormalizations, you are able to say something about the original map. So in that sense, you are not really iterating the original dynamic itself, but in a sense, you are iterating the coordinate changes. Or not quite iterating, but it's you are taking an infinite composition of coordinate changes. Okay. And there are various types of renormalizations. And I think these first 2 weeks, there were discussion by Marco Martens on the Feigenbaum type renormalization for unimodal maps. In this case, starting from one interval, you get two intervals and four intervals and so on. And if you take intersections, you get a contour set. The another case is a circle map with irrational rotation numbers. In that case, starting with this cut point, you just divide the interval. And then you take a first return map, you get a further subdivision and so on. So in this case, you get a partition of intervals. Okay. But today, I'm going to talk about a complex map, because a complex one-dimensional map, which is close to the irrational rotations. So in this setting, I don't have a natural partition of the phase space, but somehow there are overlapping covering of the phase space. Okay? And so essentially what I do is a covering of this punctual neighborhood of the fixed point by sectors and with overlapping domains. And I explain more about these domains. And then you have to glue these sectors by overlapping regions. And you have to define the renormalization through this picture. And there are some difficulties coming from this picture. Because in this setting, you have a natural partition of the phase space or even to the proper subintervals or partition of the interval. So it naturally comes with the dynamics. And then if you want to conclude something about the original dynamics, once you know there's some information or a priori bound about the sequence of renormalizations, it is easy to use this partition of these, the phase space. Okay. So the partition is right there at the very beginning of renormalizations. But in this setting, if you don't have this partition with overlapping covering, there's the difficulties if you want to try to go back to the original map. Suppose you know something about the sequence of renormalizations, but still there are problems going back to the original ones because there are overlaps and so on. So that, for example, the rigidity question is more difficult to tackle. So that's one of the topics I want to mention. Okay. And before going further, let me review what was known a long time ago about the local dynamics of the around the irrationally indifferent fixed point. So first of all, if lambda has a modulus less than 1 or greater than 1, then it is linearizable. So if modulus is equal to 1, but with a rational rotation number, it's called a parabolic fixed point. And then there are case of there are infinite dimensional moduli for local analytic conjugacies. And then for irrationally indifferent case where alpha here is irrational, in some case it is linearizable, that means it's conjugate with the irrational rotation. Then as I mentioned, there's a Ziegler disk where the linearization is defined, but there are cases where the map is not linearizable. That means there is no conjugacy to the irrational rotations. Okay. And this happens if alpha is a Diophantine or a Bruno number. And if it's very reliable, then it's not linearizable. It's not known. So such a point is called the Kramer point. And Ricardo Perez-Marco has defined an invariant set called the hedgehog around such a fixed point. And this is his picture in his paper that he imagined that there are like some hairs or continuous curves accumulating to the fixed point. And this was at that point, it was only a kind of picture, the mental picture of the around the fixed point, and that I try to justify this picture in the following. Okay, and what my plan is to try to describe the local dynamics near this Kramer case using the near parabolic renormalization, and I'll be focusing on the case where you have a quadratic polynomial, so no higher order term. And also, I'm focusing on the case where alpha is an irrational number, but if you write down the continuous fraction expansions, I assume that these questions are all large, larger than some fixed number. Okay? And I'm going to construct a model for such an invariant set, local invariant set called the hedgehog. Okay, so let me define the renormalization in my case. This is different from a Feigenbaum or rotation-like map, the circle map. So in this case, start with a map with a fixed point zero, but I assume that there is another fixed point close to the origin. Okay, so there are two fixed points, and then I assume that you can draw up a circle curve like this. It can be just around the circle. And assume that its image goes out and the bounds, this Croatian shape region. And if you identify inner curve with image by this function f, you get the quotient space, which is topologically a cylinder. But I assume that it's isomorphic to the C over Z, bi-infinite cylinder. So it will be like this. Okay? So this is a hypothesis. So once you can do this, then if you look at an orbit starting from very close to the end of this Croissant shape, then, oh, sorry. And once you can realize that this quotient is isomorphic to C over Z, you can use the exponential map, e to the 2 pi I z, to send the C over Z to the punctured plane. This is honest exponential map sending Watson. And the upper end point will correspond to zero, and the lower end point correspond to the infinity, okay? And then if you start with a point near the end of this croissant, then you can be sure that the orbit will come back. The micro start from middle, it may go away somewhere, but near the end, it is coming back. So that will define the first return map at the end of the cylinders, and then that will define return map or renormalization near the zero or near infinity. And I'll be focusing only on the inner part of the near the origin. Okay. So this way, this is my definition of a cylinder or near parabolic renormalization. After this hypothesis that you have another fixed point and the quotient is cylinder, then you get a new map defined near the origin. Okay. And this map extends to the origin, and it's analytic. And so when can we assure that this hypothesis is satisfied? So if you start with a map, which is a perturbation of parabolic map, so this one has a derivative 1 and a non-zero second term, and if you perturb such a map into this e to the 2 pi alpha z with almost real parameter alpha, then you can assure that this construction can go through. So that means there is another fixed point and the quotient is cylinder and RF is defined. So for general setting in renormalizations, I needed a rescaling of fundamental domain or some domain to this fixed domain. But in this case, it is far from affine rescaling. So it is you are taking this quotient by the dynamics and uniformize this abstract Riemann surface to C over Z. And then in addition, you take the exponential map to come back to the plane or near the origin. So this will be my rescaling in the renormalization. Okay, so if you can do this, that means it's a small perturbation of a parabolic germ. Then and if this can be continued for infinitely amount of time, then you have a construction this way. So you start with a map, two fixed point, fundamental region, quotient cylinder, then take exponential map and so on, okay? And then you try to conclude something about the sequence of renormalization. And once you know something about the sequence of renormalization, you want to conclude something about the original dynamics. Yes, so essentially alpha has to be very small, and alpha is corresponding to the continued fraction coefficient, and that's why I require high type irrational numbers. Okay, thank you. Okay, so let me explain a little bit more about this construction. So start with this type of germ, and suppose you have two fixed points already, so zero and another one sigma. Then I define a new coordinate. It's called the pre-Fatou coordinate, W, and it is a mapping from this plane to this original dynamical plane. It's a mapping from this plane into the Riemann sphere minus two fixed points. So it's a universal covering map, and the deck transformation is a translation by minus one over alpha. So it looks like this, okay? So sigma is a fixed point. Just believe me that this is a universal covering map onto this sphere minus two fixed point, okay? So, and I have rescaled this coordinate so that the deck transformation is like minus one over alpha, translation by this quantity. Then you can conclude that you can lift the dynamics here to this plane, except some region corresponding to the complement of some disk here, okay? Gray region corresponds to the complement of the disk. Then there's a lifted dynamics from F to the capital F, and this lifted dynamics is almost like a translation by one, so by small bounded constant, okay? So for example, if you draw a vertical line in this coordinate, its image goes to the right by one, almost one here on also, and this gives you this curve and its image. So that's why you can draw a curve which looks like a croissant shape, because this is a very explicit function, and you can trace what's happening in this coordinate, and it gives you these fundamental regions. Okay, and once you get the dynamics, which is very close to the translation by one, it is now possible to conjugate this dynamics to the exact translation by one. But, well, this is called the Fatou coordinates, but it's the domain of definition is, for example, somewhere here. You have to avoid this black region corresponding to the outside, this here, because I lose the control of the dynamics. And so I have another domain of definition here, and defines another Fatou coordinates. Then they are compatible with this deck transformation. So whenever you have orbit like this, the orbit is mostly translated by one to the right. So starting from this fundamental region, orbit will eventually arrive to the other region that corresponds to the returning orbit of the original dynamics. Okay. So let me go again, and I have this picture with a universal covering map. And I said that this region you can define the Fatou coordinate, which is a conjugacy to the translation by one. And this region, again, I have a conjugacy to the translation by one. But here, since I have a translation by one, you can just take a vertical strip so that this will go to there. And if you start with a map, say quadratic polynomial, then you have a unique critical point. So critical point may be mapped to some corner of this pattern. And then you can just map it back by Fatou coordinates. And this is a picture. So around here, it is almost like identity. So the vertical strips will be translated into almost vertical strips here. But since this map has a critical point somewhere, there's a corresponding critical point here. So if you take an inverse image, here you have a corner, then the inverse image will have a more complex structure, more branching and so on. And of course, the inverse image of this point will have more branching also. So I try to cut off these domains by lower end and some other part. And I only keep this part of this domain. And you can show that if you take a quadratic polynomial or some class, which I don't give you a definition, but there's a well-defined definite class of functions for which this can be carried out. That means you have one critical point and you have these patterns by Fatou coordinate and pull it back when you always see the similar picture. So you see a universal pattern of these domains coming from this vertical straight strips on this attracting Fatou coordinate, okay? So it doesn't depend on any particular F, but if you take a map from this class, you always see this picture, and the orbit of lifted dynamics goes like this, okay? So I have a theorem with Hiroyuki. You know about this sequence of near parabolic renormalization. It's a kind of a priori bound for the sequence of renormalization. And I guarantee that for the sequence of renormalization just I define, I can always do this, that you recognize some universal patterns within this picture, okay? And so this pattern is universal. You always the same, you always have the same kind of dynamics in here. And what's the difference between one F and another F? So you take a different F, so what's the difference? So the difference comes from this deck transformation. Because remember, this was a universal cover, and there was a deck transformation by minus one over alpha. And this was a universal pattern, but deck transformation gives you a kind of identification of this end and this end, okay? So if you take this abstract universal patterns, you have to identify kind of right edge of this picture and left edge of this picture, and I call this identification by theta f. So in a sense, you can translate this observation into the term that you have kind of universal domain and the canonical map defined on this universal pattern, and this pattern is not dependent on each f or r end of f, but the only difference comes in as a difference of the gluing of this left and right edges. So this is a canonical representation of this local dynamics. And since I had to cut off the dynamics by this kind of domain, I can't cover a whole neighborhood of zero and sigma, but I only can cover a neighborhood of zero not including sigma, and this part of the neighborhood is very tiny, and this part is large so that it includes a critical point. Okay, so you, at least it is a neighborhood of the origin, and it has a kind of isomorphism between this universal pattern together with the identifications. So to recover, once you know that this sequence of renormalization have this canonical representation, you want to conclude something about the original dynamics. And to conclude something about the original dynamics, I have a difficulties of this kind of gluing problems, because as I said, for the Feigenbaum or circle maps, you had this canonical partition to start with. So once you know something about the sequence of renormalizations, you are able to conclude something about the original dynamics, like the smoothness of the conjugacy and so on. But here, it is only a covering map with some overlap, so I have to kind of deal with these difficulties. So suppose you cover the punctured neighborhood around the fixed point by sectors. This is an oversimplified picture, but let me just do this way. So suppose this domain, like a sector, goes here, goes here, goes here, goes here, and come back almost, maybe not completely, but almost. So this sector will be like a fundamental region, or in this original pictures, I draw this croissant-shaped domain, but I'm going to ignore a neighborhood of the other fixed point. So it is like a sector. It's very much distorted, but it's like a sector. And it's if you take the whole images of F, by F, then it will cover a punctured neighborhood of the origin. And that is going to be the fundamental region. So this is an oversimplified picture. But then you identify this fundamental region with a kind of horizontal half strip. So this going to the fixed point is like going up, like to the I infinity. And this edge corresponds to this edge. This edge corresponds to this edge. And if you look at the dynamics here, this edge goes almost close to the other edge, but not completely. So you'd have to take some regions here and here. And by the first dynamics, the F maps this region to that region. Okay. Then the definition of this renormalization was that you glue this fundamental region by the dynamics. So you identify this edge and this edge, and it gives you like a cone-like region. And if you uniformize as a Riemann surface, you get some cone region, and that's uniformized as a punctured disk. So again, in this picture, going up corresponds to going to the fixed point. And then return map going around this region and come back will define the renormalization of F in this region. Okay, so this is the picture simplified in this way. Okay, so this is one stage of renormalization, but of course in this case we want to continue the construction of renormalizations. So what happens next? So I assume again that you can construct this sector covering and the fundamental region and so on. So that will define some regions like this. And in fact, this will give you the next refinement of this chart or the sectors. So start with the original one. Each one had this identification with this domain. And the image, the pink region is like this. But if you have further sectors inside the renormalized map, you're going to have, again, these domains inside this. And so if you forget about this initial big domains, you get the sequence of smaller sectors and then glue them together, and that will be the renormalization, second time renormalization of the original F, okay? So this way, if you know what to say about the gluing, you recover the renormalization of F in this shape, okay? So let me be more concrete, so this is a picture. So let me show you again. So this is a fundamental region. And then, well, local picture would be some realistic shape of this domain was something like this. And as I mentioned, so this local dynamics in this region was like some universal domain pattern, and the canonical map defined on the one, which does not depend on each F, but there's a gluing between left edge and right edge, which depend on the each dynamics. But in this case, this is coming from the renormalization of F. So G correspond to this renormalization of F. So these are identified. So that means fundamental domain is essentially a domain like this, and with together with these identifications. So how can I recover knowing that this local dynamics is canonically represented as this domain together with gluing? How can I represent the original dynamics? So this is the answer. So if you have five domains like this, five sectors like this, I prefer five copies of this canonical domain corresponding to this one. Then left and right edge now identify not to itself, but to identify the next one. Okay. And the next one also. And then what's the dynamics on this region? You just map identity, and most of the time identity, but in one place, I use this canonical dynamics. So once you are here, it's easy to see that if you compose until you come back here, you realize this canonical dynamics, okay? But you have to change this gluing a little bit so that it is compatible with this dynamics. But once you do this, you can check that this is a compatible gluing. So this is a kind of abstract picture of local dynamics around F, starting from this canonical representation of first renormalizations. So you can show that if you do this, it is well-defined after gluing. Second, return map is F canonical map modulo this gluing. So that means that's isomorphic to this picture. And then actually this picture does embed into this F. That means there's isomorphism into the subdomains here, and the F is conjugate to this dynamics. Okay, so once you know this picture, so you can do this construction infinitely many times. So starting from this one, there's a local canonical representation, and then the renormalization of this picture was, again, has this canonical representation. Then what happens? So if you have these pictures, left and right edges are identified, and the identified region is a slightly darker shade of yellow. So this region will be double covered, and this region will be like a single covered. And then remember that by definition of renormalization, you take a fundamental region, vertical strip here, and glue the left and right edge and get a sector or a punctured disk. So the one punctured disk corresponds to this fundamental regions. So try to lift this domain into this region. And I'm sorry that I have to draw the handwritten picture. So there's the original picture, the canonical representation, and try to go back by the renormalization. This domain will be very much distorted so that it looks like this red domain. And in fact, there are many possibilities of fundamental domains, so there are many copies of such a domain appearing here. And that's the isomorphic image of this canonical domain. Okay. And this was a canonical representation for F. So for one picture, you have a canonical representation, and inside there's a canonical representation for the next one, okay? And then you have to continue once more. It's very difficult to draw even by hand. So suppose you have this one and canonical picture for this one, then you have a kind of induced the domain within here, and its inverse also has a domain here. So this one was the previous domain isomorphic to this one, but there's a next canonical domain which is kind of drawn within this one, which is very difficult to draw. So anyway, there was a zeroth level of domain, the first level of domain which is isomorphic to this one, and second level of domain which is isomorphic to this one, but there are many copies for this one, and there are many copies, and this one for next one, there are more, even more copies. So there's a way to number these copies of the domains, and there's a shrinking, the descending sequence of these domains corresponding to nth renormalization and so on. Okay. And each one is isomorphic to this universal pattern truncated by left and right. And it's like this. And they are glued by this gluing on left and right. And the gluing left and right is given by nth renormalizations. Okay. And then finally, what you do is you collect all domains according to some index set. Then you take the intersection of all n's. So, and this is the definition of this invariant set. And this is an invariant set. And the dynamics on this lambda is a homeomorphism. So the global map may not be a one-to-one, but the restriction of the dynamics onto this set is a homeomorphism and contains a critical orbit. So this is a construction of an invariant set. And I want to describe a little bit more about what happened here. So I have to index these domains because there are many copies to start with. And you need some consistent indexing of these domains, which is given by the sequence of these integers. Okay? First level, you have one integer. Second level, you have two integers to index. And let me mention how it comes out. So the first approximation to this indexing is like a product space of this z over k1z and so on, where if you take a rotation number alpha with these coefficients, this first approximation of this set will be like this product space where this is identified with an integer interval, like a half of this coefficient and another half of the coefficient to the negative side, and zero is around the middle. But this, of course, this is not completely the right way to describe. But anyway, the faster approximation of this dynamics or the action of the dynamics on this index set is like a odometer or adding machine. So the usual adding machine or odometer is like you are adding one, and whenever you see one, you carry to the left and so on. And if you have a 99, then you carry to the left twice and so on. So this is carrying to the left. But the first approximation of this combinatorics is you have to add either one or minus one according to these signs. And whenever you see this digit, you carry to the right. And also for the usual odometer, when you see nine, you carry. But here I define this odometer map so that carry all occurs not at 9, but at 0. Okay? But once you have this odometer with this dynamics, the return time with the product of this k1 and up to kn. But of course, this is not the correct return time, because if you know the continuous fractions. So you have to modify this odometer map to something like a broken odometer, or some people call it Danjoa odometers. So sometimes some digits have a more digits, more than 9 or 10. So you have to include an extra digit, like a 9a, and then you go to 0. Or you have a broken side here, so you have a 9 and a carry, but you carry immediately before going to 9. So before, in this digit, you don't see the 9. So when you have a 9, 8, you carry to the left. So you have to modify this digit a little bit so that it is consistent with the rational rotation of the dynamics. So anyway, I don't want to give you the detail of this construction, but you are able to modify this set so that you can describe the combinatorics of irrational rotation in terms of such a set, and it is modeling the irrational rotation. So you take the inductive limit, the inverse limit of this ANs, and the induced dynamics is actually conjugate to the irrational rotation on the circle. Okay, and now I want to describe the invariant set. And before going to the description of invariant set, let's set aside the irrational indifferent fixed point, and let's talk about the exponential map. So if you have an exponential like map like this, if you take a yellow domain like this, its inverse image will be something like this, and its further inverse image will be like this. So you have subtract the inverse of this domain, half plane, indexed by the integers, and then if you take a further, you have a subtract going in here, which will be indexed by z times z, okay? And then if you continue this infinitely many times, you have a set which is indexed by the z to the n, so infinite sequence of integers. And the dynamics is like a shifting on this space. And the Lempe had a very explicit description of this Julia set. For example, when you have an attracting fixed point, the Julia set looks like this. Then first, you, as a symbolic space, you take the infinite sequence of integers, and then define the model dynamics, which is defined on the product space of symbolic space times a half line, okay? So in this picture, half line goes to the right, and the symbolic space will be going vertical, and the model dynamics is on this side, it's just a shift, and then on this real line direction, you have exponential dynamics, but also for there's an effect of symbols coming from this second equation to here, it's subtracted, so there's a case that you go to negative, so you define a subset of this product space as a set of this pairs such that when you iterate this dynamics, the second component is always positive. So when if it goes negative, you just discard this orbit. So initial product space will be like this, but there are some points that when you iterate this one goes out of this right half plane, goes negative, so you just remove this one, you get this subset. And if you do this further, it gives you the set which is similar to this one. And Lempe shows that under this assumption, this set is homeomorphic to the Julia set, and the dynamics is conjugate to this one. And we want to propose this similar model for the maximal hedgehog. And so this is my straight brush model or Lempe model for the hedgehog. So instead of exponential map, I had this renormalization map. And the important part of renormalization was that this exponential map going from cylinder to the punctured disk. This is exactly exponential map together with other uniformizing map. So that's why the dynamics should look similar to exponential map in certain sense. Now I start with this Danjou automata or symbolic space, which I defined in, well, I didn't define, but I explained in two seats before. And well, this definition depends on the rotation number alpha. Okay. Then for the sequence of rotation numbers for according to the renormalizations, you get the starting from alpha, which is alpha naught, you get the second rotation number for the renormalization, which is defined this way, and so on. So I get a different Danjou odometers for alpha n and alpha, sorry, I forgot to modify, but this is should be alpha n plus one. So alpha n and alpha n plus one. And then the model map, in my case, will be something like this. So on the symbolic side, I use this shift map. And then this, this real line side, I have a function of this form, which is kind of modified by this symbolic part of the dynamics, which is similar to this exponential map. Then the model space will be that when you start with this one, you iterate this dynamics, and you ask that the second component is always non-negative, then that defines a straight brush model like in the case of exponential map. And the theorem is that if you start with, say, quadratic polynomial or a certain map in a class, then and as, if you assume that alpha has, is a irrational number with a large continuous fraction coefficient, then the maximum hedgehog I define is homeomorphic to this set. Okay? Just to remember that the function actually is similar to this exponential function for t small and close to this linear function minus log alpha inverse for t larger than log alpha inverse. And in fact, this type of function appeared in the definition of condition H in Yoko's work. So it's a Hermann condition for global analytic conjugacy. So it naturally appears, this type of the functions, for these conditions. But to describe the phase space, I need to subtract these factors. And anyway, this is the way I can describe the maximal hedgehog as a kind of a subset in this product space, the symbolic dynamics, and a line. Okay. Let me stop here, and thank you very much.